I'm not a computer expert, and I usually let real pros handle setting up servers. However, a Linux computer is different because it serves one person at a time. Here are some simple tips for keeping a Linux computer safe and private, especially for beginners. No system is completely secure, and it's important to stay up to date. But I think there's a fine line between wanting reasonable security for your everyday computer and being overly paranoid. There are solutions for the first case, but I'm not sure about the second. Good news is going around about how viruses affecting Linux systems don't have a big impact. This is because there are fewer people using Linux. However, reliable stats tell a different story. According to the CrowdStrike blog, in 2021, there was a 35% increase in malware targeting Linux compared to the previous year. This increase is mainly because many Linux servers handle most web and email services. Some experts also blame the rise of IoT, Internet of Things, where smart household devices and less powerful gadgets, running on Linux and connected to the internet, become opportunities for attackers to get into our home networks. Sometimes, it's the user who unknowingly puts their system at risk. So, it's crucial to understand how to handle each security aspect properly. Don't go into overly complex stuff, as that might make things worse instead of better. But here's some reassuring info. Project Zero, a Google team focusing on IT security, found that Linux and Mozilla developers are faster at fixing vulnerabilities with updates and patches than even Apple and Microsoft. In simple terms, an average user can use Linux on their regular computers more securely than commercial operating systems, as long as they aren't involved in illegal activities or targeted for personal opinions or activism. Linux has built-in security features. It manages permissions for users and their groups. Some Linux versions, like Ubuntu, Linux Mint, and Pop! OS, encrypt your disk or home folder during setup. This is handy for laptops or if your PC has important data others might access. Fedora and Red Hat Enterprise Linux-based distributions use SE Linux for added security. It enhances permissions and access controls, keeping applications isolated in secure compartments, called sandboxes. Ubuntu AppArmor and similar tools in other distributions offer added security. KDE desktops have Plasma Vault for creating encrypted folders anywhere. But users may tweak settings without considering security. This can be risky, especially for services, potentially leaving your PC vulnerable to the world. Backing up your personal data is really important. Even if it seems like a small and unrelated thing, doing it can save you from a lot of troubles. Just store your backups in a different place than where your data normally stays. I've mentioned this before, if your computer's operating system gets messed up, you can reinstall and set it up again without much trouble. But if you lose important personal data, there's no easy fix. You might want to blame someone or a mistake, which is normal, but it doesn't change the reality. Regularly back up your data and keep those backups in a safe place. I talked about how quickly Linux developers fix security issues. To keep your system safe, the most important thing is to quickly install software, security, and kernel updates as soon as they're available. This is because when a problem is found, everyone knows about it, and the longer you wait to update, the more vulnerable your system becomes. If you don't have trouble with data limits or don't want to do it manually, you can set up automatic updates. I want to emphasize this point: install updates quickly, and don't use an operating system after the support period ends. If you follow this advice, you'll be in a good position. You can even stop here. The following suggestions add details but are not helpful if the system is not updated. You might have heard that Linux doesn't need antivirus, and I agree. If you install software from your system store, it's safe and verified. When an issue is found, Linux developers quickly fix it, and you get updates fast. Linux, especially on a workstation, doesn't need antivirus. The AV Test Institute only evaluates antivirus for Windows, macOS, and Android, showing Linux isn't a concern. Some antivirus programs like ESET and Komodo offer Linux versions, but they mainly focus on Windows threats. If your Linux connects to Windows workstations, using antivirus can help prevent spreading threats to others, not directly for your system. Using Wine for Windows programs on Linux can expose your system to Windows threats. In this case, antivirus is useful. I recommend avoiding Wine and keeping a Windows partition if you must use software that doesn't support Linux. There's a special antivirus for Linux called ClamAV. If you don't want to use it through commands, you can get it with a simple interface by searching for the ClamTK package in your software center. The program might not be very new, but the lists of virus definitions are still updated. When you install ClamTK, it doesn't come with the antivirus daemon, which is a service always running to watch every file you open. This is good because it can slow down your system and use a lot of memory. You can check files and folders manually or set up scheduled checks for your home folder and what's inside. You don't have to check the rest of the system. It's not necessary, but you can also add unofficial definition lists to ClamAV, as StreamShock is a trusted source. However, be careful because adding more definitions might lead to false positives. With the modern devices that help our internet connections at home or work, some people say it's not super important to turn on the firewall. They say that Linux doesn't open doors to your computer from the outside. But not everyone agrees. The Linux Mint team suggests, on the welcome screen, to enable the firewall immediately using the pre-installed tool, along with the UFW firewall. This isn't just for Linux Mint, it's the same for many other types of Linux. If you use systems like the eDonkey network or torrenting, or if you share things on your local network with Samba or Warpinator, you need to add specific rules so those services can reach your computer. There are already some preset rules organized by type. Once you find the service you want to allow, just click Add Rule. Repositories are like storage places for software on your Linux system. The official ones are safe and have approved packages. You can also add other repositories and PPAs to your trusted sources, especially on Ubuntu-based systems. Another option is installing programs from files you download, deb or RPM, but be cautious because these aren't always checked by your system's developers. They might affect your system's stability and security. When you add a PPA, you're giving permission for new packages to be added to your system by those who manage it. This is a big deal for your system's safety. I'm not suggesting you only use the programs in your Linux distribution software center. I can integrate various programs now, but those in the software center are the safest. I recommend using a PPA only when you really need it for a specific program. If it's a well-known program or drivers from official websites, and you verify the file's signature if possible, you can trust it. Don't download and install unknown programs without checking online or in your distribution's forums. Look for tutorials or reviews from reliable websites. Logging into a computer session as the main administrator goes against the security rules I talked about earlier. So much so that many systems like Ubuntu or Linux Mint turn off this account by default. The programs we use every day are made to work with regular user permissions, not the super administrator ones. This means they can't make big changes to the core system. Only tasks related to system management should be done with superadmin privileges, and only when necessary. For instance, if you use the sudo command before a task, you're giving yourself temporary superadmin powers to carry it out. Using sudo when it's not needed is not just a security problem, but it can also mess up how the system works and cause different kinds of issues. For example, if you run a daily program from the command line with sudo, it creates files and folders that belong to the superadmin and not you. It's also possible that your user loses control over configuration files and folders, and they end up under the superadmin's control. People say the best password is one that's so hard you can't remember it. Think about all the accounts and passwords we have now. It's overwhelming. If you avoid letting your browser send your important passwords all over the world or saving them in a text file, you're already doing a good job of protecting your personal info. To make storing important passwords, like for your online identity, banks, etc., simpler and safer, I suggest using a password manager. You can find Bitwarden, KeePassX, or KeePassXC in the software center of your Linux system. They might seem similar and even confuse you with their names, but they're different projects. These open source tools let you use one strong password to protect a bunch of credentials with really strong encryption. Since they're open source, anyone can look at the code. They don't snoop on your data or send it who knows where. So, using these tools is a great way to reduce the risk of your super sensitive info getting into the wrong hands, especially if your system gets hacked or you lose your laptop. The most commonly used program on all devices, not just computers with Linux, deserves a closer look. This applies even if you're not specifically focused on Linux. If you're searching for pirated software or engaging in illegal streaming, you're inviting data leaks into your computer. These activities are the main culprits behind such leaks. The primary rule still holds true: promptly update your favorite browser to enhance security. You can also opt for browsers focused on security, like Brave or Opera. Many of these browsers proactively block ads that track your activities or identify you. Some even come with a free VPN service, such as Opera. You can't be really safe without keeping your privacy. Regular internet search engines aim to learn all about you and what you're searching for. They gather this info to give advertisers details about you, so they can show you ads that match your interests. Newer business models are emerging. These search engines support themselves by displaying ads paid for by advertisers using your search terms. However, they don't capture, store, or sell any of your data, including information about your device, habits, or personal details. Certainly, one popular alternative search engine is DuckDuckGo, and it's gaining more and more users. If you already use it, checking out the extra info about its philosophy can make you even happier about using it. Unlike Google, which tracks you on its apps and 75% of the world's websites with AdSense ads, DuckDuckGo lets you turn off sponsored ads in your search results. In return, it suggests you help spread the word about the search engine. I use StartPage as my search engine. I felt a connection with it right from the start because of its clear explanations on how it works. StartPage doesn't store your IP address or personal info. Instead, it sends your search terms, which then compares them with Google results and sends them back to you anonymously. With StartPage, I can give specific commands and use advanced search options from Google to make my searches more accurate. Malware seldom comes from extensions and plugins. What's crucial to understand is that extensions and plugins usually keep an eye on and record all your online actions to function properly. They ultimately end up in the hands of their creators. Nevertheless, in sessions incorrectly labeled as anonymous or private, these extensions aren't activated, preventing such tracking. It's advisable to restrict the quantity of extensions and plugins for security, performance, and stability reasons. Still, some are genuinely beneficial for enhancing security and privacy, and I'd like to highlight them. NoScript is a tool you can use on Firefox. It helps you stop potentially harmful programs that use JavaScript, Java, and the old Flash player languages. If you completely turn off these languages in your browser settings, you might miss out on some useful web services. With NoScript, you can make specific rules to allow certain websites, like your bank's site. To use NoScript well, you'll need to spend some time learning how it works. Firefox multi-account containers help you keep different websites separate. When you open a site in one tab, it can't see what you're doing on other tabs. This is important because otherwise, websites could track your activities across different tabs. For instance, if you have Facebook open in one tab, it could potentially access information about what you're doing in other tabs. This extension also lets you use services like social media or Gmail with multiple accounts simultaneously. You won't have any issues with them interfering with each other. When you close your browser, all the cookies are automatically deleted for privacy. The dark web, also known as the darknet, is a place where illegal activities happen using onion domains. However, it's not just about that. The Tor navigation system is a good way to enhance privacy and stay anonymous online. Usually, when you want to visit a website, your internet provider sends the request to the site's manager. Once you get the information you asked for, it comes back to your computer. If the website uses an SSL certificate, your browser shows a closed padlock, meaning the communication is secure with HTTPS. Even if someone tries to intercept it, the encryption makes it unreadable to prying eyes. With the Tor network, your request for a web resource is encrypted and sent to a server managed by volunteers worldwide. It goes through several servers, each in a different place on the planet, with each step using a secure connection. This makes it nearly impossible for the website manager to identify you. Your internet provider or Wi-Fi administrator may know you're using Tor but won't know what you're doing. ProtonMail is a safe email option that keeps your messages private by sending them in a secret code. Unlike regular email services, a Swiss company runs ProtonMail, and they follow strict privacy rules. If you're not confident in the company and the Swiss regulations, ProtonMail ensures that the secret codes used to send your messages are made on your own device. This means even the people who work for ProtonMail can't understand your messages. ProtonMail also comes with a calendar and a space for documents. These are connected to the servers in a secret way to keep them safe. What makes ProtonMail special is that you can use it on the Tor network in the Onion domain. This means if you sign in through this system only, your emails are not just secret, but no one knows who you are. I've mentioned before that privacy is closely connected to security. If your Linux computer's home folder isn't encrypted during setup or if others can access your workstation, it's a good idea to erase recent activity traces, like recently opened files. However, even temporary data, previews of open files, and installation logs can reveal a lot about your activities if they fall into the wrong hands. I usually don't recommend cleaning and optimization apps. Windows users often obsess over these programs, but Linux doesn't really need them. Stacer, on the other hand, is an exception. Its cleaning functions are something anyone with a bit of knowledge about Linux can easily understand. Stacer's cleaning settings are limited and not overly aggressive, with clear and individually selectable options. You can easily find tutorials and videos online to guide you. If you're not sure about changing service settings, disabling auto-start applications, or deactivating repositories, I strongly recommend not making any adjustments. Tails is a kind of computer system based on Debian. It uses the GNOME graphical environment and includes the Tor protocol for browsing. Unlike regular installations, Tails runs only in live sessions. The main goals are to ensure security and privacy for online activities. When you use Tails from a DVD or USB, it doesn't impact the existing operating system on your computer. Tails loads into the computer's memory, RAM, and all activity disappears when you turn off the computer. It's worth noting that Tails provides Tor browsing and other privacy tools, available in the original file from the official website. While using Tails from a USB stick might make the system a bit less secure, it allows you to update or install new programs using a persistent partition. We've covered a lot, from native Linux security features to privacy-oriented distribution. Remember, security is an ongoing process, and these tips are here to help you navigate the Linux landscape with confidence. If you found this video helpful, don't forget to like and subscribe. Until next time, stay secure and happy computing.